Welcome to Barbell Logic Rewind.
Welcome to the Barbell Logic Podcast. I'm Scott Hambrick. This is Matt Reynolds. We have Gillian Ward with us today. So Reynolds came over to our house one day and we trained and trained and then we went and ate Mexican food.
Okay.
And Matt said, blah, 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 Gillian Ward, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, what? He's like, wait a minute. You don't know who Gillian Ward is? She is the strongest woman who has ever lived.
I think I said the greatest strength athlete.
Nope.
Female.
No, you said she is the strongest woman that ever lived. And you go, wait, stop right now. And then you got your phone out and you passed it around. And that's my Gillian Ward story.
I was like, look at this girl. What's up? I'm glad you're here. So we've known each other for a long time. Mm-hmm. Probably almost 10 years now. Not quite, but close.
I think so.
So I really do want to tell your story because your story is insane and it's awesome. And I want people to hear your story. So I want to know when the first time you did anything fitness-like that you can remember, what was the very first thing?
It's probably before I can remember because it's a story that I've been told. But when I was a little kid, the only thing I ever wanted to do was to be able to fly. So from what I was told, I used to stand on the top of the landing and most kids will go down in maybe a laundry basket, but I would stand at the very top of the landing and just jump off of it and just jump down the flight of stairs or roll down the flight of stairs. Crazy stuff, like trying to pick things up or pull things out of the floor that were part of the floor. And
the wood planks in the floor.
But very, very strange things. So my parents signed me up for gym swim at 18 months old.
Oh, wow.
Pretty early.
Gym swim?
Yes. But I still haven't learned how to swim.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, you can swim a little bit, but not really, right? Like you're kind of scared of water.
Like not at all.
You can't even doggy paddle like in a, like if you went to a hotel pool that was 4 feet deep, you couldn't start doggy paddling and stay up?
No, I just frolic and look nice.
And you do. You frolic on your Instagram page.
Yeah. It's amazing. So, and then you... Was really the first thing that you did where you got serious was gymnastics?
It was, but I was very serious at playground stunts.
Okay.
So
what does that look like? What does that mean?
Like monkey bars and just like...
No, I think I just very, very young realized that I could attract attention in the playground by doing some kind of crazy stuff.
Come on, you know you have a story that's a specific example where you called out some kid... There was a boy 3 years older than you, and you're like, "But I can jump further than you."
No, I do have lots of those stories, but I think
what do I have to do to get you to tell one?
Well, it all started. So I started gymnastics at roughly 2, pretty serious about it by 5.
Okay,
and I was not, and I wrote an article about this, but I was not the best girl on the team. So I was strong, but I was a mess. You know, I was always picking my wedgie and my nose was always running and my hair was unruly and I was just a mess all of the time. So the coach would pay attention to the pretty girl or the graceful girl or the girl with good dance skills and I wanted to be the best. So somewhere along the way, I realized that that was just going to come from working really, really hard. And some of my early physical skills actually come from being punished. So if you do something bad in gymnastics, you'll pay for it by saying, you go do 50 push-ups. Like if I yawned when you're not supposed to, drop and give me 50 push-ups, sir.
Bella Caroli, your coach, or who was your, had to be some Eastern European.
It was.
Of course it was.
But there was a girl on the team and she was my best friend and my biggest rival and I wanted to be better than her. And I had a coach that is like, you need to get strong. And that was the one place that I was able to excel was that I really, really worked hard and I worked on fitness and I became just obsessed as far back as I can remember with just feats of strength, like superhero stuff. I'm like, I want to be able to fly and jump and, you know, swing like Tarzan. And I would get hurt all of the time. There were a lot of emergency room visits in childhood. But from as long as I can remember, I was fascinated with doing things that people told me were impossible.
So interesting.
It is interesting. So you competed up to what level in gymnastics? You were like a national level lift or national level gymnast at some?
Yes, but young. So that I probably peaked my abilities around 14 because that's okay. For some people when fear sets in.
Sure.
So once you get afraid and if you don't have inherent trust in your coach, if you start to have doubt, it's really over for you. So
did that happen to you?
It did happen somewhat. I had a couple injuries and a couple of my friends had serious injuries and it scared me. And so then I branched off. So the rest of the time in high school And later on, I ended up doing gymnastics, track and field, and I started a physical fitness team. So,
which was a competitive physical fitness team?
We did.
Pre-CrossFit.
Yeah, right.
It started, if you guys remember, the President's Physical Fitness Council.
Yeah.
So we had that in junior high.
That's right.
My junior high school teacher looked into the Marine Corps Physical Fitness Challenge, which is a battery of five tests they do in high schools across the country. It's push-ups, pull-ups, 2 minutes of sit-ups, a 300-yard shuttle run, and a standing broad jump. And it's competed across the country at the high school level, but he entered us in at junior high school. And when I got to high school, I was like, we don't have a team like this. And I started the team. And we had a physical fitness club and a physical fitness team.
How did you do on that team?
I was the national champion.
This is why it's going to be a hard interview.
I know.
I just happen to be the best in the world.
In the world, right.
This is, by the way.
Did you get to meet Arnold?
Listen for a theme of this. This is about to be the next six stories we tell. You got to meet Arnold Schwarzenegger?
Not later on.
Okay.
When I won something else.
Yeah, right. Yeah. We're getting there.
No, Jackie Joyner Kersee was the one that did the award ceremony for that. Yep. But I wasn't the best the first time out.
She had long nails. Mm-hmm. Didn't she have long fingernails, right? She was a sprinter. Right?
Yes.
Sprinter and track. And she had really long, like insanely long fingernails for a runner.
Yes.
I don't know why I remember that. I think she was on the cover of Sports Illustrated. I like obsessively read. So you were the athlete. You were the obsessed athlete. I was the obsessed guy that read about athletes. I would like read the Sports Almanac and memorize the. Yeah. So, and then, so Presidential Physical Fitness and the fitness.
So I have a funny story about that.
Yeah.
So we had to sell M&Ms. In order to raise money to go to the national championship, which is at MCRD every year in San Diego. And you would go.
And let's just go ahead and tell people where you're from, as if they can't quite figure out the
New York
area.
City, Queens.
Queens. Go to Queens. Coming to America. I'll tell you everything you need to know about Queens. Sorry, go ahead.
And the fitness team selling M&Ms.
And the fitness
we
team
had to sell M&Ms
to go all literally as far away as you could possibly go from Queens.
But I ate all of them and I never sold them. So about once a week I would ask for a new box and the coach thought that I was selling them, and I think there were 20 of them in a box.
Not a new box of M&Ms. A new box of case of M&Ms.
A new case of M&Ms. Peanut, most of the time peanut. And we may get into this later, but I have a junk food addiction. And I ate all of the M&Ms. So when the time came to give our money in, I had no money. He said, well, you need to do something. I said, well, I think we may be a push-up-a-thon and we'll raise money like this. So we put this thing together. It was going to happen in the auditorium at lunchtime when people had study hall. And basically, people were going to sponsor you per push-up, and anybody that wanted to sign up could do this on the main stage in the auditorium. So I went around with something, people 5 cents a push-up, and the rule
was
that
you?
At this time I was either 15 or 16.
Okay.
So this is kind of when all the weirdness started.
Okay. Au contraire.
So you're going around raising this money.
So I'm raising money because I ate all of the M&Ms. And we have this push-up-a-thon, so we have about 2 weeks to get pledges, 20 cents a push-up. And the rule was that you had to do one set, touch the floor, come up to full lockout at the top. Once you stopped.
From your toes.
Once you stopped.
Legit push-up.
Or put your butt in the air, or moved a hand or a foot, you were done.
Wow. So super strict.
So there was a boy on the fitness team. I hope he listens to this.
Let's call him out. What's his name?
Come on.
Brad Herman.
We're looking at you, Brad.
And the other girl, Kim, who is my rival in gymnastics, were like the two people that I had challenged to this. Well, we all start together. And that day, Kim did 60 consecutive push-ups.
Really good for a girl.
Fantastic.
Phenomenal.
Brad did 100 push-ups.
Also phenomenal. And you did?
I did 400 push-ups and the bell rang.
Lunch was over.
She did it for the entire hour.
And then things got really weird from there.
You broke a bunch of kids. They're like, yeah, I'll give you 20 cents a push-up. You build them for 80 bucks a piece.
So,
paid for the M&Ms and then some.
And that's when she was 16. So that was like 4 years
Mercedes
ago.
With my push-up money. So then what happened?
It got progressively weirder.
Yeah.
So there was a record board on this. You know how in the school gymnasium, you'll see records for whatever they are. So
but shot we have put to go, record and like whatever.
We have to go back to when I got to junior high. I wanted to join the weightlifting club. And at the time it was the late 80s and they're like, no, the girls do aerobics and the boys do weight training. So you could come to school an hour early.
First off, I'm offended by how sexist that is.
But that's how it was.
It's not fair. Let the girls do all the same things the boys do.
Oh, I thought it's because you wanted to do the aerobics. You wanted to wear that leotard on the outside of your tights?
No, I already have.
There was good music on that side. I remember like it was like Pump Up the Jam or whatever. It was late 80s, but I did awesome. Not want to do aerobics. No. I wanted to be on the weightlifting side. And I went over to the coach, the gym teacher, Mr. Hammer, and I said, I want to weightlift. And he said, you can't. You have to do aerobics. And at the time, I was in seventh grade. I said, what if I break all of the ninth grade boys' records right now? He's like, well, that's not happening. So it was like a pull-up record, a push-up record, rope climbs, dips, whatever it was.
It was all body weight stuff.
It was all body weight stuff. Right. And he's like, the girls can't do pull-ups or whatever it was. So I looked over, and in the next 20 minutes, I took down the ninth grade boys. So
so you were in.
And I was in, and I was allowed to join the weightlifting club, which wasn't really weightlifting, but we exercised, and we bench-pressed a little bit. And my friend Jennifer joined us for that. And again, this carried over. So when I got to high school, and here's where it gets to a funny story, we had the same type of record board in the gym. And I looked at so now I'm in ninth grade, and I said, well, I want to break all the 12th grade boys' records. And some of them took some time, and I said, I'm going to break these records where they will stay there until the building burns down. And that was what my goal was.
So this freshman, this young woman, a freshman, she's like, all these guys in deep puberty, gonna wreck it.
So
she's like, it took a little while.
The thing is, you know, the guys that have the records are no longer in puberty. They like look, you know, they look like Burt Reynolds.
Oh, yeah.
Like, and she's like, yeah, that guy over there that's like, that's driving the Trans Am with the mustache.
Right.
I'm gonna beat his record.
So I started to chase that. I was still at the same time doing gymnastics, running track. And I got it in my head. I'm like, this is what I'm going to do. I want to do 80 pull-ups. You know, at the time, like I want to try to do, and the records were nowhere close to that. So during the course of the next year, I basically, my poor high school boyfriend. So he came over every single day.
And what was his name?
His name was Darren, and he was very good to me. And he spent the year laying on the floor in my house, counting my push-ups. And then my mom would give him dinner and he'd go home. And that's all we would do. But I chased.
So no good stories there. Moving on.
Yeah, I do feel sorry for Darren.
Yeah, me too.
He got abused a little bit. He was a pitcher on the baseball team and they sort of didn't let him live it down that his girlfriend was.
Happened to be the strongest, best athlete in the entire high school.
Right. And a very large high school, close to 5,000 students. But when I finally got done, I mean, the records, the interesting thing was, you know, my sister went to the school a few years later and people looked at it and they're like, that's not possible. And 20 years later, 25 years later, like the records are up there and they're yellowed and there's like folklore because nobody believes that that person ever really existed.
Right, right.
That's so crazy. I want to say at the time, like my push-up record on the wall at that time, I want to say it was 600 consecutive. My pull-up record, 81. bench press body weight for reps was over 100.
Over 100.
My mile run got broken. It wasn't so great.
So what school was that?
Benjamin Cardozo in Bayside, Queens.
So when did Guinness come around?
Can we go to the recent story?
Tell your first Guinness story.
Okay.
Okay. No, that's fine. Sure. Yeah. And then we'll do the throwback.
Okay. So 2 years ago, I've done, and I get criticized because I jump all over the place from sport to sport and people think
as
that
someone who coached you for a few years, I can
and I have no attention span, but right. To me, it really is all the same. It's focus, right. It's effort, it's hard work. And there's so much that translates between one and the other. And we all get criticized. I'm like, well, why don't you just be really good at one? And I understand that also. And for me, it's not even a matter of that. It's just kind of doing what I love. And I see it all as the same thing. But a couple of years ago, I was a little bit done with powerlifting and weightlifting and bodybuilding. And I decided that I was going to make another attempt for the Guinness Book of World Records push-up record. But in doing so, what I wanted to do was raise money and awareness for for physical education in public schools.
Julian, I cry on every third show.
I do. Yeah, we like to cry.
Yeah.
It's our best thing.
Yeah, this stuff matters to us, you know?
No, it does matter.
So yeah. I went to 60 schools and I taught a fitness lesson and a nutrition lesson and did a bunch of push-ups with kids. And I had my curriculum sent out over you know, kind of across the state and had planned to get to more schools, did a bunch of speaking, Rotary Club, anybody that would let me kind of talk about it and just get people moving and show them that it just starts with the simple, most basic things and just how young you could start and just get somebody doing something because something's better than nothing. And I invited everybody, we streamed it live, and I invited everybody in the 60 schools and all the kids to watch in their schools if they were able to or to come to the event, which kind of put me on the spot because now I'm making a world record attempt, broadcasting it live and letting all of these people that I've spoken to for 6 months come and watch. So I did 1,190 push-ups.
Amazing. How long did it take?
So the nature of what the record is, there's so many different records. So I can't say that. I'm not going to say it doesn't have meaning. But if you look, there's a record for this and a record for that. But the push-up record that I had wanted to go for that was its max push-ups in an hour. Because to
oh my
me,
gosh.
Part of the problem is that people, form is different. So I don't know. I saw a video recently of a guy breaking a push-up record and his form is like, he's moving 2 inches, but I'm like, right. I'm going to honor form. So if you're honoring form, push-up is going to take probably a second, I mean, at least a second to complete, sure. Or close to a second in correct form. So a lot of pressure to train for that, knowing that I was going to host this big event and invite people to it. And I think back when I trained for that. So my goal, the record was, I want to say just under 1,000. Whatever, I was shooting for 1,200. I got to 1,190. My mother almost stopped me. She was hysterical crying because my body started to break down around 900 and she couldn't handle it and wanted to come in and pull me out. And everyone's like, do not, you are not stopping her.
So what does that mean? Your body's starting to break down, cramps?
No, you could see distress. Like the other thing, and I used to get criticized in CrossFit, is people didn't think I was working hard because you don't see distress. From years of gymnastics, my breath control is very monitored. My facial expressions are very monitored. A lot of the time when I'm under distress, somebody wouldn't know it. So I was at CrossFit, well, she's not going hard enough. She doesn't lay on the floor. She doesn't grimace. She doesn't wince. She doesn't. And it's just me really understanding how to control those things. So versus like pacing. So what I did is, I just did 20 push-ups. I did 10 push-ups every 30 seconds. And that was, is that what I did? That would have made sense, right? Yeah, yes. 10 push-ups every 30 seconds and would rest the remainder of the 30 seconds and had known.
In full lockout position?
No.
You could come down.
Yep. And I had known just from keeping lots and lots of records and having somebody that would sit near me and take notes through
Brad.
That. That I could go, you know, 6, then I could go 7. But if I went 13 in a row, that's too many. If I go 10 in a row, so I had known through pacing over the period of, took me about 6 months to get there. But a lesson I had learned so much, I never count. I only count to the number one. Whenever I do, I think when you say strength, you know, I know that I've hit big numbers in the gym, but my muscular endurance is probably what's the most phenomenal. And I think it's really psychological because I never count beyond one. I say to myself, I can always do one. I'm going to do one perfect rep.
So who counted for you?
Oh, who counted for me?
Yeah, specifically, who was kind of your coach that was paced, make sure you paced right?
During the event.
During the event, not during the event. During the event, the entire crowd counted, okay. But my friend Christus counted in my ear for that.
To keep you.
But I didn't, I would know what the total was, but I didn't listen. And that's something that I had learned. I probably started doing that like when I was 9 or 10 years old and would start doing this kind of stuff. And I was like, I can do one. And in gymnastics, it's all about form. And I'm going to think only of this. And as soon as I put that, as soon as that one rep is up, that's put away, I'm on to the next one to prevent the anxiety or I have so much more to do or getting off pace. I just went off on a crazy tangent.
No, that's
right. Okay, I'm all over the place.
So you broke the record.
Yeah.
But you didn't quite hit your 1,200, but you were really close.
So... correct. And I also went for the pull-up record on the same day and realized that may have been a little bit too much. It's going to be fairly long. It's proving to be, so body weight wasn't so much of a factor with the push-ups. So you've seen my body weight change because I'm a bodybuilder some of the time. Sometimes I'm a
powerlifter, CrossFitter. You've done all of it.
All of those things. And they have different bodies that go with them. But I actually did the push-ups at a heavier body weight. Than what, and which seems counterintuitive. I was about 155.
Okay.
And
you're short. How tall are you?
I'm 5'4", and I would say my weight,
5'2",
but like contest weight, is low as low to mid 130s.
Yep.
And like fat happy power lifter.
Yeah. You could be 148 a lot, and you would cut to 148 to get there, right?
So right. But like normal me walks around probably closer to 160.
Yep.
So the push-ups I did on the kind of the heavier side of it, because I was doing in the neighborhood of 3,000 to 5,000 push-ups a week, and you're going to eat to recover from that.
Sure.
And I still always squatted 2 to 3 times a week along with that, squatted, pulled once a week. But what I'm finding is now I'm trying to do the same thing with pull-ups and broaden kind of the spectrum of what I'm doing with the kids. But that body weight is a much bigger factor.
Sure.
A much, much bigger factor.
Needs to probably come down a little bit, right?
Yeah.
Even I would think 10 pounds would make a big difference. Yep.
And yeah. At what point in the training, so I've been out on the boat drinking every weekend, so over the summer, and the pull-up record.
Like, I don't want you on a boat with just no swimming stuff.
Yeah. It doesn't.
Yeah, we just lost like 9 people in Branson on a ride the ducks. They were on a boat, couldn't swim.
I thought they got trapped. They didn't.
No, I mean, have you seen a ride the ducks?
Yes.
You don't really get trapped in a ride the ducks. It's an awning on the top of the thing. They got trapped because they couldn't swim.
They got trapped because they were in the water.
Right. They were trapped by the water.
Because... I hate you.
So, I'm sorry. This is so bad. I'm sorry. It's a true story, though. It's true. So
the pull-up thing.
You're going to have to lose a little weight to do the pull-ups to break the record.
So the record is close to 800 in an hour. It's actually so 7 insane. And change. So it's an average, whatever the record is right now, it's an average of 12.6 a minute. And it's okay. A dead hang pull-up.
Right.
And I don't know that I understood that doing 12.6 pull-ups a minute.
It's tricking.
It is. So right now, what I've worked up to is I've done 8 on the minute for 40 minutes, and that's where I'm at now. But, you know, the push-ups I knew
8 on the minute
I had,
for 40 minutes.
It's a lot.
Yeah.
And
how many pull-ups do you think you could do in an hour?
In an hour? God. I can probably do 15 every 5 minutes.
But for how many times? I mean, that's the thing.
Well, I mean, if I was going to get out an hour.
Ooh. You think you'd do 60 in an hour?
Maybe. Maybe. That'd be
away.
The last thing I ever did.
Yeah. They, 1 a minute.
They definitely go away. Like they.
Yeah.
It's been very humbling. I mean, there's other stuff like you have to get body work done, like the amount of tension headaches. So I think this is going to be a longer goal, which is challenging to me because setting my sight on something that may not have the immediate reward of 3 months from now or 6 months from now, and maybe I may be setting a date a year from now, but along with setting that date, I'm planning to get out into the community and talk about it immediately.
Yeah.
I like being in those pressure situations, but that's sort of what, that's my next thing, I think.
So what do they give you when you get the Guinness Book of World Records record?
You don't get anything.
You don't even get like a plaque, like a picture,
a scroll
or something that says
that you don't. So it's actually pens for a long period of time and stuff. So the mistake that we made was with this, a video submittal, as opposed to spending the money on the officials. So it's still considered to be pending, which could go on forever, but the officials should be flown out in order to do something. When we do it again, we'll absolutely have officials. But in my mind, every dollar raised in any capacity was going towards these kids. And the good part about it was they let me choose how the funds were delegated.
I was going to ask. So I know you're trying to raise awareness for physical fitness in the United States, but what do you do with the money?
I get to choose. For most of it, I'll choose more educational stuff and teaching, like buying equipment. But buying equipment is only one thing. What I really want to do is teach. You could give the kids stuff, but unless you show them how to use it.
Yeah.
So my plan was this year, though, would be to get more kids into the gym for strength training, offer scholarships and stuff, not necessarily to promote just my business, but a lot of what I do is very local.
Yep.
And we get people. So what happened was just getting behind this thing, so many other people got involved and came out to teach the kids. Like I would go to a Rotary Club meeting and they're like, well, we want to go to the schools too with you and go teach this. So it was a really, really big kind of community project. And I'm hoping to do that on a bigger scale with the pull-up thing.
Yeah, that's cool.
And I always pick a movement that everybody could be able to do. So I had the kids doing the push-ups with me, and that choice was that, you know, maybe not everybody's going to do a pull-up, but they could do some variation of a pull-up. Maybe they could do it with a band.
Sure.
You know, maybe they could do a 45-degree body row or something, but I will specifically choose a skill that I could teach and somebody could do it without spending money.
So, anybody can do a push-up or work towards push-ups.
Yep.
So let's go to a throwback. That's a good lead-in to your original push-up contest.
Yep.
So as things started to get weirder and you sort of set all these records at high school,
yeah.
At some point you got in contact with the Guinness people and you were like 16 or 17 years old.
And set the record in high school. So the high school thing for me, I don't always talk so much about it because I was a physically fit, strong, muscular woman in today's day is far more accepted than it was at that time.
Sure.
So, and I think, you know, CrossFit's had a lot to do with that, but like when I go out now, most of the response to me, or a good amount, there'd still be negative, but there is a lot of positive response. It was not like that 30 years ago,
sure.
or 25 years ago. I mean, I was abused, made fun of. The New York Daily News, a very large New York City publication, once did an article about me, and the title of it was, "Is She Human?" So imagine this on a 16, it was actually 17-year-old sure. when I set the record, "Psyche, is she wow. human?" And the first line was, "Beneath her baggy shirt, her biceps bigger than all of the boys."
Right.
And when you're a 17-year-old girl in high school, that's not what you want to read. So I made my mom drive around and try to buy up all the copies so nobody else could have them, which wasn't going to happen. But I have kind of mixed feelings about that time. I did set the record. I did 978 in 1995. But I dealt with so much adversity, and I'm more proud of myself for pushing past the adversity and continuing down that path than any specific athletic accomplishment at that time.
So what came after high school?
A lot of fun. So I bounced around a lot. I did recreationally did gymnastics.
As one does.
Yeah, of course.
After college.
As I still do.
You do?
No, I can barely walk.
Sports-wise, what came after high school?
Well, at some point you started sort of focusing, at least for a short amount of time, on bodybuilding, right?
Yeah.
In the late 90s?
Yep, I did get into bodybuilding a little bit for a short period of time. You don't know anything else. So when sports end for you at that time, there's not a lot of options for women, so you just become a gym rat. So I became pretty much a gym rat. I still dabbled in some sports, but I had become a gym rat. I had my parents buy weights for me. This is probably another fairly good childhood story, but I would hide all these muscle magazines under my bed. And if I could get weights, or if I found weights in somebody's trash or like the sand filled ones, and I would hide them. And in sixth grade, my parents like, "What do you want for Christmas?" And I'm like, "I want a universal machine with all those things on it." Like, "Where are you going to put them?" Like, "In my bedroom."
Right.
And every night I did every single exercise.
So you got one.
I got one.
You did it.
And my sister was so embarrassed by me. She'd like pass by my room and close the door with her friends. She's like, "Don't smell my sister. Don't go near her."
I'd be in there
sweating. I had three. I had the Rocky soundtrack.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, Flashdance, Footloose. There had to be some other movie, maybe St. Elmo's Fire and Rocky. And I would do every exercise. I had the Encyclopedia of Bodybuilding, and anything I could do, I would do. So I was a gym rat. I got into bodybuilding. In college, we had a very active bodybuilding club in the school. Like, Mike Katz used to come MC the bodybuilding show every year.
From Pumping Iron?
Yeah.
The big forehead.
Yep. And then I got into the industry, you know, as a trainer and stuff, worked. And then in my 20s was all over the place. I did some competitive ballroom dance for a while.
By the way, we don't have to go down that, but you know, like, if you ask her about, when she said, "I did some competitive ballroom dance."
I was not serious. Okay. I wasn't good
at
that.
You didn't win the world championship at ballroom dance.
No, I just like the costumes and the shoes. I did a little bit of that, but I was mostly working, being a gym rat up until, and I came across CrossFit because American Gladiators fell through for me. So
did you notice how she brushed by that story?
Right.
You know, when I didn't quite make the American Gladiators TV show.
So
CrossFit, that's 2007 that you discovered it, kind of at the end?
No, we can't let this American Gladiators thing go. So what happened with that?
And what was your name going to be?
Chaos.
Okay.
Yep. So as a child, I would always write to them to be a contestant, and I would get the form letter back, and I wasn't old enough to go on the show. So
no, you set all those records at the gym at your high school. We don't want you to humiliate our staff.
They resurrected the show, I guess, in 2007, and I trained the girl, Jamie, that played Fury. And she ended up blowing out her ACL and they were going to replace her. And she had an in. Yes. And I was cast and I'm like, they're throwing a party. They're making a jingle for me. I'm leaving my job. Cast as a gladiator, and then the show gets cut. So I'm devastated.
It's not that you didn't make the show, it's that the show...
You were in.
I was sure. They had a little bit of a problem with my height, but that was another. But at the time, like, Gina Carano was on the show.
Oh, yeah. So, okay, that falls through, and you're like, hey, there's this... How did you hear about CrossFit for the first time?
I worked at a place called La Palestra, and there was another trainer there, and I was pretty upset about the gladiator thing.
Like, by the way, La Palestra, amazing gym in downtown Manhattan.
Correct. Right?
Which I got to go there a couple times.
It's yes.
Crazy. And you would, and there's like lots of celebrities went yep. there, and they were like, it was very respectful and kind of hard to get in. And there were like private areas where celebrities could kind of train and they get left alone. And right. It was interesting. It was interesting stories there too.
Yes. So one of the other trainers came over to me and I was sulking because this was sort of a dream of mine and I got to wear costumes.
And this is what it's really all about.
It is.
Well, it's superhero. Yeah. Superhero thing, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
It's really
yes,
cool.
Absolutely. And he said, you should try this CrossFit thing. He said, I have a CrossFit Games. He's like, you go win the CrossFit Games, you'll forget all about the gladiators. So I said, all right, show me this. So we went into the office and he pulled up the website. And the workout of the day, that day, was Tommy V. It's a hero workout with rope climbing and thrusters. Had no idea what thrusters were. Was good at rope climbing. Attempted this. Tore up my leg because when you climb a rope 20 times and you don't climb the rope, you tear up your leg. But I was happy with my, proud of my battle wound and went home, looked up CrossFit. And at the time, it was really just the black box in Manhattan and CrossFit South Brooklyn. And signed up for Elements or Foundations class the next day. And you know Stacy Rudnitsky.
Of course.
We started out on the same day and we started together, training partners for a couple of years, still training partners when we can be. So we started the next day and the 2008 games were 13 weeks later. So I was like, here we go.
So you started doing CrossFit 13 weeks before the CrossFit games in 2008, which 2008 is really the year it blew up, right? 2007, it was still kind of a... So good old boys club.
It was. And this is when I started getting attacked for my diet. So I did my CrossFit level one Memorial Day weekend. I started on right after St. Patty's Day. So
you went and got CrossFit level one certified.
On Memorial Day.
I'll bet the coaches are famous. Who are the coaches?
Nicole Carroll. Of course. I mean, the whole crew was there, but yeah. Glassman and Annie got a call after I did Fran that day. So they called, Nicole called Annie to tell Annie I beat her Fran time.
Oh my God.
So I do my level one, I go to the level one, all excited, drove down to Charlotte from New York.
Your level one, how long had you done CrossFit when you went to get the level one?
9 weeks. So
9 weeks.
Okay. St. Patty's Day to Memorial Day.
Okay.
Is that about it. 9 weeks? Yep. So I want to say I was definitely the first female, whatever, maybe the first person to do a sub-3-minute Fran at a CrossFit.
What was the Fran? Sub-3-minute Fran.
And
this is in early 2008.
Correct.
Okay.
Early 2008. So CrossFit's still relatively small at that time. And afterwards, the funny story is not that. It's when somebody took a peanut butter and jelly sandwich out of my hand and told me I was killing myself and going to get diabetes. So I do this, Fran. Everybody's got their zone paleo. I guess yeah. more zone, but yeah. zone paleo
zone first.
And yeah. stuff, weighing the stuff, counting their almonds in the car. And I remember going outside and somebody offering me almonds and something the CrossFitters used to make with like a date and an almond and a piece of bacon or something. And they're all counting their stuff. And I had a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, a chocolate milk and a banana. And they just sat and looked at me. And this girl is like, that's going to kill you.
Yeah,
and
you'll be like, dead.
What's your Fran time?
Yeah, right. So, and
how did you do?
How'd it go?
I came in third, but I was so there's only one event on day two, and I was in first after day one, and I was pretty sure I had day one. I was pretty sure I had it locked down.
You were gonna win the whole thing. You're like, I got this.
Well, there was one event left, and I was, and then two awesome athletes or whatever. The next day was a heavy grace, which is not heavy at all anymore, but it's 30 clean and jerks for time. And at the time, the weight announced was heavier than we were accustomed to. And that was the year that the theme was every second counts. So your score was basically just the sum of all of your times. So the person with the lowest time won. So it was all timed events. And then they both got in front of me.
Yeah. Who won that year? Was it Bill Henniger's wife?
Yep.
Yeah. That's right.
Yep.
What's her name?
Katie Mauner. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Crazy. Who took second?
Tanya Wagner.
Oh, yeah. That's right. Crazy. And then it really exploded. Now you got offered, didn't you get offered an Under Armour?
I did.
Sponsorship out of that,
yep.
Right?
Yeah.
Which is a pretty big deal.
So they were kind of talking Under Armour at the time. Maybe Under Armour was there at the games.
Didn't have the big title sponsor. Reebok hadn't signed on.
No, yet. All right. Of our gifts were Under Armour gifts that would come at the time. It was what we got. And it was an awesome time. But I think...
She loves costumes. She loves shoes. I've already picked up on this.
So then shortly after that, wasn't too long after that.
I got hurt. Yep.
What'd you injure?
So I used to train. Do you know Rob Orlando?
Of course.
Okay. So I would go up to Connecticut. We'd do a bunch of stuff. And he talked me into... this was another fundraiser. So I did something for Hope for the Warriors. And at the time, like muscle ups were considered hard. And I was like,
they're still hard.
So I did this thing. I was like, I'm going to raise money for Hope for the Warriors and veteran stuff. I'm like, I'm going to do 100 muscle ups. And every time for every, whatever it was. And we had a big event at CrossFit Long Island City. And during the training for this, I started getting some shoulder and like nerve problems and stuff, but I was ignoring it. So, which is not, I mean, that's an unhealthy movement for the shoulder. And at the same time, Rob had come up with some ridiculous workout, like, you know, 50 body weight cleans and 50 body weight push press, whatever, some ridiculous thing for time. And we were filming it. So he had put it out there and both of us like failed at doing it the first time. So we kept going back and trying to do this workout. Well, we were filming me doing this workout and like Mac noticed that I kept shaking this hand and I couldn't feel my right hand. But I knew I was using it. I'm still going. I'm like, and he knows I won't quit. I'll die before I quit. I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing, but I'll die out there. So I'm like, I don't feel my hand. I don't really feel my face, but I know that they're still there.
I know my face is there.
So, that's
competing.
Oh no. The first responders treated it like a stroke.
They thought you had a stroke. Yeah.
That came a little bit later. So anyhow, get through the workout, having these weird symptoms. I go to train a client and I went to load a barbell and I picked up a 25-pound plate and just twisted with it while looking at somebody and stuff. And I thought somebody shot me. I felt like a pain through my chest and back and heat shoot up my face. And I couldn't move my right arm and the right side of my mouth was kind of slack. And it's just like a nasty cervical thoracic, like just discs that were pretty messed up. So that kind of took me, that scared me. It took about 3 months before I was able to like really touch a barbell again. And it really made me think because I had never been out my whole life. My whole life, all I've ever known is being an athlete. And to think about who you are in the absence of that and what your worth is and your value and all that stuff. So I wrote, did a lot of writing during that time. But when I came back, I started to be a little bit more intelligent. So I still CrossFit for the next year and a half or 2 years, but I was no longer competitive because I was no longer willing to take that kind of risk.
Wow. And that's 10?
That was 11. I was still tinkering with CrossFit between, up until that point.
And then I started coaching you in 12, maybe, is that right? Or 13, somewhere in that ballpark.
Yeah.
Somewhere in there. And you started powerlifting.
I did in 11.
And then we set you became the number one 148 in the world.
Only for a short time.
As you do. And which had nothing to do with the coaching.
But that was...
If there was ever anyone that I can take zero credit for whatsoever, it's
you.
You were...
I listened to you. It was amazing.
I can remember you... You would report back to me what you had eaten and you'd be like, I ate... you know how
a gallon
of ice. You know how the Oreos, there's like three rows of Oreos. She's like, but I had two of the rows.
That's nothing.
And then she would go, but listen, it's okay because I told all the sugar to go to the muscle cells, not to the fat cells. I talked to them and she would never get above about 6% body fat.
There's more to that story. So people always tease me. I got hate mail in CrossFit. There's a CrossFit video of me doing some crazy workout and stuffing down like street hot dogs immediately following it. And on one episode of CrossFit Radio, I talked about my poor diet and got physical hate mail about just that, you know, our children listen to you and whatever, and you're eating all of this stuff.
What a terrible role model you are, eating hot dogs.
I had this story that I would tell just because it would make people, they're like, she's just crazy. And people would say, well, you eat anything. I said, yeah, I was like, you know, I was born when Elvis died or whatever, the summer of 77. And the ghost of Elvis lives in my cells and he does his little dance and turns partially hydrogenated oils, artificial colors, flavors, trans fats, all into muscle. And I would just say, and people are like, oh, this is crazy. That was it.
Yeah. So, man, so you've done everything.
What's next, though?
Well, and then
the pull-up thing, but the powerlifting thing, interestingly enough, my squat was probably, to me, my most emotional physical goal ever, because I'm strong, so people don't realize that I fear heavy loads.
Yeah.
Because heavy is relative.
Yep.
So my biggest fear is getting under a heavy barbell. And that's not something that people would know. So hitting a heavy squat for me was probably the most emotional, profound thing, yeah, because it was the one thing that I was terrified of.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't want to say it because I'll get kind of picked on again, but I will probably step back on stage this year in bodybuilding.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. I'll already be losing weight for pull-ups.
Right.
Yeah. So you kind of focused on strength through about 2014, 2015.
And that's the butt. Yeah.
Right. And then you started to focus on bodybuilding. Was there a coach there? And you're in North Carolina, kind of the Crystal Coast,
yep,
area of North Carolina. And was there a coach there that sort of got you involved in bodybuilding?
I had a great coach, but it was a client that walked in to learn. So Mac had deployed. I had hit some big numbers with you.
What were those numbers?
My meet numbers are all time.
Either. They're close.
So some of them are the same. So my, yeah, biggest squat was in a meet and it was 400. Biggest meet bench was 281. Gym bench was 285. Deadlift 485. And my press is whatever, still stuck. I've hit 185 for
a double. Right?
Yep.
185 for a double strict press female.
I had to look over there at my wife.
Yeah, Charity's chasing you. Charity's the second best presser in the country. So that's good. So you started to focus on bodybuilding. And I remember you telling me that, and I was like, this girl eats sleeves of Oreos. It's not going to work.
Yeah, well, all you have to do is just eat one sleeve.
Right.
No,
and tell that sleeve to just go to the muscle cells, and how bad can it be?
I did the diet for real. So
yeah, you did.
A girl walked into my gym. You saw it. You, yeah, saw it live at the Arnold in 2016.
I did. I came and saw you at the Arnold.
So a girl walked into my gym, and she wanted to learn how to squat so that she could grow her legs for figure competition. And she saw me, and at that time, I had hit some big numbers, and I was scared, and Mac was deployed, and I didn't have a training partner, and I was getting the anxiety. You know when it's like you put so much pressure on yourself that you get yourself sick over it? And I would get myself sick over squatting, and a little bit needed a mental break. It just was something that, I needed a training partner. It's on my own. And she's like, you should consider physique. It's a new category. I think you would do really well. So she came there for me to teach
that.
Her.
So physique is now, so they've moved away from women's bodybuilding. So it's sort of like ginormous, like in the, lots of people are not super happy about where men's bodybuilding has gone with,
right,
these guys with like massive sort of growth hormone guts and like enormous drug usage and stuff like that. And so they actually got sort of rid of women's bodybuilding to not,
correct,
encourage that style of body work.
Right? Yep.
And so physique was the more muscular step above what's the one?
So it's
that?
Above figure, figure, but it was sort of initially supposed to be like throwback bodybuilding of sort,
right,
of the golden era, like,
right,
Corey Everson's, like, yeah, kind of from, yeah, that time. So a little bit softer, not striated, not, you know, clean lines, good aesthetics,
yeah,
more natural of a look than, yeah, women's, sure, bodybuilding. And so that became the replacement of women's bodybuilding. And it's sort of changed a little bit again. And I never intended that to be anything other than one show.
Yeah.
So that was just sort of like, well, I'll just get back on
that
out there.
Right.
So that kind of snowballed into something a whole lot bigger than that I wasn't expecting it to be. So I competed. I want to say I did the North Carolina State show, won that. And then you go to like a national show, the first national show, I think I came.
Was it NPC's show?
Yeah. So, yeah, there's, I don't want to get the number wrong because someone's going to come and tell me that I got the number wrong, but there's several national shows a year. And if you win a national show, you get your pro card. But the national shows have, like, when the year that I did North Americans, there's 1,300 competitors.
Right.
So it's a pretty dense field. So I ended up going pro after three shows. Like it took. So
going pro is code for I won one of those.
I won. Yeah. Well, you win a state show, then you win a national show, then you're a pro.
An IFBB pro.
Right.
Yeah, so first off, there are lots of federations in bodybuilding.
Right.
And the only one that really matters is the NPC and IFBB, right?
So right.
The NPC
feeder body the, for that.
The feeder,
yep.
Right. Powerlifting sort of has a similar sort of thing with IPF is the only thing that ultimately matters sort of at the world level. And so you went into the best federation in the United States as an amateur there's a handful of national competitions every year for NPC national bodybuilding competitions. You won one of those and you won your IFBB pro card.
Correct.
So now you're like got into this thing as just sort of a fun hobby for a show or two. And the next thing you know, you've blinked and you've got an IFBB pro card and now you're a pro bodybuilder.
In 9 months. But what happened was it added, which I hate this about it because I was the same coach when I had the same credentials, I had the same knowledge, the same skill set.
You
when
can't
I was
teach the squat any better as an IFBB
Correct.
Pro than you
but
could.
But all of a sudden, I triple used some pretty pictures of me on the internet. I could triple my prices for my online program.
Good.
People respond.
Good.
And that was upsetting to me at the time.
You should have called me.
But it definitely gave my brand and my business a level of visibility and stuff and brought new clientele in. And again, it happened much faster than it was only going to be a show. But I kind of pursued it for the last couple of years. I've come in it and out of it. And that's primarily because it is all encompassing. I always train. I never miss training. I've trained for, you know, I started gymnastics at 2. I'll be 41 next week. And other than a couple of injuries that took me out, I have never stopped.
Yeah.
And even those injuries were brief.
Yeah.
So tell us about your business.
I own a gym. It's also a CrossFit affiliate in Emerald Isle, North Carolina.
Called? What's the name?
It's called...
You're bad at this part.
I know.
Good at the stories, it's bad at the marketing.
Crystal Coast Strength and Conditioning.
Okay. What's the website?
These people from Queens don't have a G in strength.
Strength. I know.
It's strength.
You say the G, the G in strength?
Yes, it's in there. It's not a... Yeah.
You're like strength. By the way, if you think she has a strong Queens accent,
you should hear
her sister.
And
her
my mother.
Sister and her mom. And yeah, so I got to meet the whole family before. It's pretty funny. I got to go to the childhood home.
You did.
Hang out. It was cool. So, and your sister, for somebody who's like, this person isn't real... And she's really strong too. She got really.
She is, and
both you guys have these sort of very small frames. You know, I said you're lying about being 5'4". I don't know if you're actually lying about being 5'4", but your frame is small.
Yeah.
So like the fact that you're 160 at your frame is you've got a lot of muscle. And your sister has an even smaller frame than you do. Like she's got a little bitty frame, but she got really strong too. So,
super strong. Yeah. Like she deadlifted, I'd say 340 at like 105.
340 at 105.
Yeah.
Damn strong.
Close to that. I could be off. She let her call you.
Somewhere
if I'm
in that
off.
Ballpark. Yeah. So Crystal Coast.
Strength and conditioning.
Right. Yeah.
So how do they find you so they can give you money?
How do they?
What's your athlete like Instagram, Facebook?
So a couple. I have my gym business and then I have my personal online business, which I probably do more bodybuilding consulting stuff with that. So what's the question?
Well, my gym. Promote yourself, ma'am.
Promote yourself.
I don't like doing that.
No, that's fine. We'll make you some money.
So you are on Instagram. What's your Instagram handle?
Gillian Ward Athlete.
They need to follow
Gillian
that.
Ward Athlete with a G.
Yes.
It's lots of fun. There's lots of chin-ups and dogs and...
Handstands all
pull-ups
over the place.
With like 200 pounds of chain hanging from her and stuff like that.
Playground hijinks still.
Yep.
Yep.
It's fun.
Yeah, sometimes you just go to the playground and have fun and still like do... crazy stuff.
I'm like the Pied Piper. I go and then all the little kids follow me and we just walk around doing
like
stuff.
Do like the human flag thing.
Yeah.
That's kind of cool. So we've got to have you out to Springfield. My daughter, Kaylin, you would be her hero. She does gymnastics 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. She like, it's insane. And she's always like, I want you and mom to come do gymnastics with us. Of course I can't, there's no part of me. You could go and you could crush her. I want you to crush her in gymnastics so that she can be like, oh my gosh, here's a 41-year-old lady.
But that's
amazing.
The thing is, like with kids, it's to have it be play, like and have it be
but
fun.
Yeah, she's 13. She's not really a kid anymore. She's
like beat her up.
No, I mean, she's starting to get to the point where she's serious about it. She's not a little kid. Now, Kinsley does gymnastics all the time too, but also just has fun with it. But if you came out and stayed at the house, we did some YouTube videos, they would be like, what? I mean, you've done that before.
Yep.
And so you've met my kiddos, but they weren't into gymnastics like they are now. So now they're... It'd be fun.
I'd love to.
Yeah. We got the trampoline. You come out and like do crazy trampoline tricks. We get them on video. So, yeah. So how do they find you? Gillian Ward Athlete.
Yep.
How else? Crystal Coast is
strength
what?
Strength and conditioning.
Is that what it is on Instagram?
We are CrossFit Emerald Isle.
Okay. You're right.
And Crystal Coast Strength and Conditioning.
Right.
And it's Crystal Coast SC and CrossFit CFEI. I should
strength,
know this.
Strength is with a G.
Strength with a G.
Strength with a G.
I was blaming it on being a little congested, but I think I'd say it that way anyhow.
So that's been an hour with Gillian. We're going to do another one, though.
Yes, this is a blast.
Thank you for having me. I'm honored.
Everybody that knows you, you are literally the best athlete. Anybody that knows you, you're the best athlete they've ever met. And no one ever says that when you ask about who is Gillian Ward. They say she's one of the sweetest humans who's ever lived. And so I think that's really cool that you can have such an athletic resume, but the thing you're known for is what a wonderful human you are. So thank you for being that. Thanks for doing the show. You also have some experiences that nobody else can really pull from. And so because you've been at the top of the game in multiple sports, as Scott was saying last night, that you probably don't get, I don't know this is true, but you probably don't get the credit you deserve for being as smart as you are because of the way you look. Like, you look so strong, and like the first thing people think when they see you is like, wow, there's a super strong lady, or there's this amazing athlete. And they don't think like, that's a super smart lady, but you are a super smart lady.
I would absolutely agree with that. I've always wanted to have a voice in the industry, but I think you're right that people see me and they look at the things that I can do. And not that they don't think I have a voice, but they're dismissive. They kind of write me off as a one-off. Well, she's just a freak, or she's just something else other than that. But the truth is that I have all of the knowledge and all of the years of work that went into it and a ton of things to speak to you about it. But most of the time, nobody asks me any questions.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to ask you some questions.
Yeah, we're going to ask. So,
you said that you wanted to talk about upper body strength and women.
Yes.
So go.
Okay. And that's another thing where when I want to address the subject, people are like, well, you're an exception. So what can you speak to? But I didn't start out this way.
That's right.
Do you have a specific question about it?
No, I just want to hear, I want you to just dump your head out into that microphone.
Yeah. Well, I mean, so we know strength naturally comes much more naturally on lower body lifts to women. And especially for a while, they can sort of keep up with men because right. of the musculature around the hips for a woman. But you really see that difference between men and women grow and grow and grow in the upper body pieces, and women really struggle with upper body strength. So
right.
how do you approach that?
So there's nothing you're going to do about the hormonal differences, but for upper body strength in women, I mean, what we need to address is muscle mass and hypertrophy. And I think especially when a woman gets done, let's say with linear progression and it'll work, there needs to be some amount, in my opinion, of addressing hypertrophy work. And some of the time they just want to continue to do the lifts, and that doesn't work. Not that the lifts alone don't work, but volume and intensity need to be addressed with that. A larger muscle is going to produce more force. So I do a lot of, with my women, a lot of hypertrophy kind of work and kind of teach them that it's in addition to the plan. But the key is to start doing some of that stuff early. And what I find with a lot of stuff that helps for that and they're not so opposed to doing is additional body weight exercises, yeah. chins, push-ups,
dips,
pull-ups, dips,
yeah.
and doing it in higher volume
yeah.
for women.
Meaning like 3 sets of 12, 5 sets of 10, like that much, or
sometimes even more.
Sometimes 3 sets of 20, like even higher.
And a woman's not going to produce like a true 1 RM. So I work and they could recover from so much. Their muscle endurance is so much greater. So we know a set of 20 for a woman is very, very different than a set of 20 is for a man.
Right.
And so much of our programming is designed around and studied around men.
Right.
So with the women, I'll generally do sets, you know, upwards of 15 in the 20 max sets with women, and they can recover from it. They're using a lesser amount of their muscle fibers.
And so get 15 to 20 in your chins, assisted chins a lot of times, even, right?
15 to 20, but even in any of the, just even to support the joints, women are, maybe it's because of less hormonal, but also less muscle mass. There's more mobility. They're hypermobile in some joints. So some of the stuff that I do with the hypertrophy work is just to support the shoulder joint
right.
and stuff. I mean, you do a press or something, like you want a strong, solid joint. And where am I going with this?
Well, so what would you do with the shoulders? So what are some of the exercises you choose to build those shoulders to the point that it kind of tightens that capsule up just a tad on women?
So I will always prioritize with the women, obviously the main lift, and the stuff will come after that. But oftentimes, I'll do an antagonistic movement first, even if it's to warm it up. Like if you're going to bench press, if I've give you an example, and this is not even specifically for women, but if I'm going to bench press that day and something, I'll stretch the pecs, open that, and I will do some antagonistic movement like rows right. or something for my back prior to getting on the bench. So doing all of that volume. So I've done, you know, I tell you there's times that I do 5 to 10,000 pushups a week, or, you know, right now 1,000 pull-ups a week. and my joints are fine. So how is that possible? There are people that do far less volume than that, and they're just kind of continuing to balance the joint. So again, if they're going to do bench press prior to that, if bench press was the main lift for the day for a woman, what I would do is some kind of pulling exercise first. Nothing crazy, maybe three sets of ring rows or something. I would bench them at whatever the requirement was for the day. Sure. And then after that, I may do, you know, three or four sets of max pull-ups and flies or some tricep exercise, but I would continue some small amount of hypertrophy work that doesn't interfere. And I could figure out how much of that to do based on the response of their lift the next time. So if I'm doing so much that it affects their ability to make progress, I'm doing too much. But if there's, if they're continuing to progress, I could continue to step it up.
Right.
Yeah, and the way I know that, there's no specific, it's a little bit of art and a little bit of science. The way I know that is just keeping really accurate logs of it. What did you do last time? What was the accessory work that we did last time? How are you feeling? Do you have any pain? You know, those kinds of questions. You made progress. We put 5 pounds on your bench. Okay, let's take that from 12 reps to 15 reps, or let's add 5 pounds.
How do you deal with soreness in the beginning? And do the women get really sore? I would assume they get really sore when they start doing it. So do you sort of titrate up that volume, or do you let them like, hey, you're just going to be sore for a couple of weeks and then your body's going to get used to it?
So soreness is something I take seriously, especially coming from CrossFit and the amount of injuries that occur and people that will rhabdo themselves. And I mean, soreness is obviously going to come from, you know, large amounts of volume, anything somebody is not accustomed to, or big eccentric. So I will be very, very same way as you would do with linear progression. I will start somebody. I'm not going to start somebody with three sets of 20 pushups on their first day. I'm going to start with sets of 8, and then the next time maybe sets of 10, or next time sets of 12. Because if somebody can't do the next workout, then it wasn't worth it.
Right.
So
it's good.
Pretty conservative when it comes to that.
How much has changed about your programming? I would assume a lot of this from a theory standpoint has sort of changed as you've converted from powerlifting to bodybuilding for a while, and then back to strength training and the bodyweight stuff. And did you look back at your younger life and say, well, that's really what I was doing with all the bodyweight stuff? And then I also then came back and did that with a dedicated sort of passion as a bodybuilder, but not maybe with as much bodyweight stuff, with more sort of traditional bodybuilding movements. And then you've started to work that in your strength training programming now for your clients? Is that what has happened?
So for me, it's come full circle. My background was obviously being a gymnast, so that is all bodyweight exercise, and being a gym rat, which I'll call bodybuilding exercise. Mm-hmm. So when I stepped into powerlifting, I would say I was already at a fairly high level because I did have the muscle mass.
Right.
And I had some amount of them. The strength came, it was there already. So there was a lot of learning technical stuff, but I don't think I would have been the powerlifter that I was had I not been laying down 20 years prior to that of that type of training.
Yeah.
When I got into powerlifting, I sort of let those movements go. And I was like, you know, just focus. If I can't get my squat tomorrow, you know, like maybe I shouldn't walk the 3 blocks today. Everything became about conserving energy.
Don't go get the mail. That's too much.
Exactly. And what I realized was, you know, I was tight all the time. My mobility was lacking, that there was a way. So for a while, you know, I started when I CrossFit, I did everything. I was like, this, and this, more is better. And then I almost went the other way, where it was like, less is more, quality. And over time, I've achieved a balance where you prioritize what's important, main lifts, and then see how much of the other stuff you could add to that. And the only way to know, I consider it highly individual, is to keep really good track of it.
Yep. So tell us about that. So you were telling me earlier that you've kept meticulous training logs for a while.
I have. I started my first training log when I was in fifth grade. Again, I worked out after gymnastics practice at night in my bedroom, and I really didn't know what I was doing. So I did everything I could think of every single day.
Right.
And I wrote it all down. And in the training logs, and I think at the time it had nothing to do with learning, but it had to do, it was just kind of like, you know what, sometimes you'll read a book and you want to keep it. And like, I did that.
Right.
You know, this is something I've done. And I did not keep it initially to learn from it. I kept it because, like a journal, it was my history.
I was going to say, it's like it was like your diary.
It was. It was my accomplishment. But it became essentially a diary and a training log. So how I felt about the workout, if I was in a bad mood when I went into it, you know, there's little doodles. I put a smiley face. I was feeling good today. I had a fight with my mom before.
You should publish
I did
these,
this
by the way.
Today.
You know that, right?
They're really important to me. Yeah. I gave one to, you know, or shared one with Mac many, many years ago. And it was a really big thing because they're very personal. But I'll go back and look at what it was often, you know, at this time. This is when I PR'd my squat, you know, for the 3 months leading up to it. You know, was there an injury, other stuff? So the more detail you could put in a training log, the better it is.
Do you write in the training log while you're training or after you're training or that night or what?
Sometimes both. Sometimes I'll write in it. I'll usually jot down what I'm doing or put it someplace and then I'll make, and I don't, they're not always kept with this type of accuracy.
Sure.
My training is in there, but in terms of how I felt and other stuff throughout, through time, you know, sometimes I'm better at it the way somebody would be in keeping a journal. I didn't know at the time, I didn't know the word RPE or what that meant,
right.
But I would have my way of saying how difficult that was. Or if I lost focus on the squat and I was thinking about what I wanted to eat for dinner and whatever it is, I would write that in there.
Yeah. It's good.
In fifth grade.
That I wasn't.
And every year since then, right? So, I mean, you've just always kept those.
I've always kept logs. At some point I realized, I think years later, and again, a lot of people don't ask me questions because they write me off as sort of being like an N equals one. Like, well, what you say isn't applicable,
right.
You know, because you can, who else is going to do something like this? But, you know, I have 30 years of data.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And actually, I think both sides of that argument are probably, there's some fairness to both sides, right? There are probably some things about you specifically that aren't super applicable to everybody else, but there's also a lot of stuff that is. And so this idea of training women for hypertrophy to build muscle mass, especially for women who struggle to build muscle mass, is clearly applicable. And training logs are applicable to everybody. Like,
right.
This is a, who hasn't benefited from training logs?
I'll tell you what's very applicable to everyone. You talked about panic in the squat.
Yes.
Or stress in the squat or anxiety about squatting. And everybody has that except for just a few mad people, just crazy people.
Yeah, and those guys are sometimes the best squatters in the world. I mean,
yeah, you know who
best,
they are.
The best squatter I ever trained with wasn't remotely scared of any weight that was ever on the bar ever. And the guy was super smart. So it wasn't like he was just a big dumb, just didn't understand even. Like, this guy was super smart. He just didn't have that governor in his brain. And so here you are, top of the sport in multiple sports, and you've always struggled with fear under the bar, specifically with the squat.
And I'll tell you what that's about. It's not fear of getting injured, and it's not a fear of failing. It is a fear of quitting. Mm. My biggest fear when it comes to that is that one day, like, what if when I get under the bar and go down, what if I have it in me not to give everything? So my biggest fear in the squat is actually giving up. This story goes back. I was about fifth or sixth grade, and I was at gymnastics practice, and I was afraid of what I was doing on the balance beam. I was doing a tumbling pass, and I got scared. And I intentionally threw the last thing off the beam because I was like, well, if I do a layout and I completely go off the beam, at least I won't get as hurt as if I straddle the beam. And I essentially quit that day. I didn't quit for good, but I quit on myself that day.
Yeah.
And the coach like ended the session and stuff and saw that I was quitting and giving up. And it was the worst feeling I ever had. And when I sat and waited for my mom that day, I made a promise. I'm like, I will never, ever, ever quit. And that, my fear when I get under the squat bar, and it is, it's panic and other stuff, is what if I chicken out?
Yep.
My biggest fear is chickening out, because if I do it once, it's easier to do it again. Is that weird?
No, I mean, it's you said that was fifth grade?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, can you imagine to be able to go back and when you were sitting on that bench waiting for your mom to pull up, to have any idea the impact that that afternoon would make on your life? That's pretty weighty. There's some weight there.
And squatting is where, for me, where it comes up. I don't know what about that more than like squatting. I make the commitment and stuff before. There's so much psychological stuff, and I'm like, I'll get into his own and stuff before I get under the squat bar. And I literally, this sounds very strange. I'm sure that I'm imagining it and stuff, but I stop hearing everything on the outside. And like, you know, I'll be like, okay, this is where everything is. I could feel the blood in my body. I feel my heart beating and stuff, and just get, this is back to the Elvis in my cells, whatever. I will like talk to like everything that I need to use for the squat. And like this really, and like, I'm going to do this. And nothing is in my mind. Like, I don't hear anything. I don't see anything. Like, I mean, a bomb could go off on the other side of the room.
Can you hear coaches coach you when you're in the middle of a lift?
Only if it's a voice that I'm tuned into. Okay. So if somebody is motivating me, or sometimes I hear nothing. You know, people talk to me about the push-ups, and if I heard everybody screaming and other stuff, and if, you know, I heard my mom wanting to stop me and I don't. So if it's a voice that I've been trained to hear throughout my training, I will pick up on that.
Yep.
But if it's a bunch of the people in the room saying, get it, other stuff, whatever they're yelling at me, no.
Nothing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's wild.
That is the only way that I may be similar to Jillian.
It's the only
if people on Instagram, they're like, what music do you listen to when you work out? I'm like, doesn't matter. I can't hear it anyway.
Right. Yep. Yep.
It could be anything. Except I was at a public gym one time. I was getting ready to bench press and Desperado came on.
You crushed it.
I'm like, this is not going to work.
Oh.
Desperado.
That's a great song. What?
Yeah, it's not a bench song, though.
Oh, I could bench now.
Well, I'm more of a witchy woman bench press guy.
Yeah. That's a freaking witchy woman's a freaky song. I'm kind of OCD when it comes to music.
Not just music.
I know I'm OCD with a lot of stuff, but I don't know why. And by the way, I know that I have clients that do this, and you probably do too. When I hit heavy, scary sets, heavy enough in any lift that's scary, almost always I have to play Metallica's Bleeding Me. I don't even know why. Like, I don't listen to that style of music. I'm too old to listen to that style of music. It's just something about that song specifically has become the thing, like it's familiarity. And so when it plays, and I don't hear it while I lift, and I also don't get really amped up before I lift. As a matter of fact, I actually like to sniff ammonia or you know, some nose torque or whatever, but I don't use it. If you watched me, as a matter of fact, when people watch me at the gym and I take a little whiff of that, it's not what they're used to seeing on like powerlifting meets and stuff where people sniff it and rah, rah, and they yell and make noise. Like, I never make noise. I never do anything. I don't want to be slapped. I don't want anybody to hit me in my back. I mean, none of that stuff, but...
So I have a funny slap story. It's a good one. It needs to be told. And I worked with the strength coach on Jim Steele out of UPenn for a little while.
Yep.
And he was trying to teach me to be aggressive. And I didn't understand what that meant. So I saw everybody slapping each other. And I was like, oh, maybe that'll work. So we were out in the garage in Virginia. And that's where Mac and I trained. And I asked him to slap me. And he's like, I'm not doing it. I was like, just hit me, like in the face, just hit me. And he's like, I am not picking a hand up to you. And I begged him to slap me before I squatted to get excited about it. And he did very, very lightly. I wouldn't even call it a slap. And you know what my response was? I burst into tears. And I had never been hit in the face. I didn't know that was going to be my right reaction. And I was like...
And then he felt terrible.
He felt terrible. And it was not... I was expecting to get excited and get amped up. Right. And instead I cried.
That's so funny.
I don't actually get amped up. I actually try to slow everything down.
Yeah, me too. I do. And that's what it is. Even with like the snorting ammonia or the song isn't a super amped up, get it really loud and get all jacked up. It's there's a familiarity and like this song says, and there's even certain measures of the song. Like there's a 20-second range of that song that it goes, this is where I get hyper focused. And then the same thing happens and everything goes away. And then as soon as the bar comes out of the rack, I don't even hear the song. Like that stuff's all gone. It's weird. It's weird the way the mental kind of psyche. So I want to talk for a second about maybe something that is not as applicable just for a minute to our listeners.
Oh, she just got super nervous. Did you see it?
No, that is that you have an ability to control at least what it appears, blood pressure, heart rate, breathing patterns, all of these things that are nearly impossible for anybody else to control. You're able to control those, not just while you're sitting here like doing a podcast, but under extreme physical duress.
I do.
How are you able to do that? Do you have any idea?
And I could watch, like if I go
and the Elvis in her cells.
I do. There's a, so when I was a child, I was always obsessed with people with incredible feats of strength. You know, how could somebody walk on their hands for, you know, a mile, or how could somebody, you know, just... How are these things possible? I'd read the Guinness Book of World Records. I'm like, I can do that one and I want to do that one. But what I wanted to do was study, how did these people do that? You know, there's something beyond the physical and, you know, just a physical and mental, like how they kind of come together. So I was obsessed with like Greek and Roman philosophers and the merging of, you know, the mental and the physical. And I would study the people that were able to do these things. and what it was, you know, read about what it was that they were thinking and how they managed that, and, you know, did a lot of work on my mind. And the other thing is, when I do these physical feats, I also do mental rehearsal. You can only train so much. So when I did the push-ups, I would lay in bed and I would visualize myself doing 1,200 push-ups at the pace I was doing, and just thinking about the training. Because I could train, you know, a couple hours a day, my body's only going to handle that, but my mind could continue to do that. And this is something, it's crazy, but I've been doing that kind of since I was a kid.
So when you visualize that, or do you think about the fatigue?
Like, I don't think about the fatigue. I think that we set limits on ourselves. Like, you know, we say this is what the norm is, and this is what, and I think is there's so much about the human body that we don't know. You know, it's like, well, this is what your blood pressure should be, and this is what your heart rate should be. Why? Like, when I go to the doctor's office, when they sometimes, they kind of get scared or whatever, like they'll go to take your pulse or whatever it is. And sometimes I'll like, I'll bring mine down. Yeah. And it's like, well, it started out at 70 and now it's 48 or whatever. And the control,
I do that all the time. I can do it on my blood pressure too.
Yep.
I can bring, but I can't do it while I'm training. I can do it. I've done that before, laying in bed or in a hospital bed, and you're hooked up to the actual monitor, the blood pressure monitor, and the, and you can play with your pulse and ramp your pulse up, just sitting there and ramp your pulse.
I did it while I was doing the push-ups. And it's really all about staying calm. And part of that comes back to where I said that I only think of the number one. Yeah. So all of that, under anxiety, I will not be able to do any of those things. So there's the physical stress, but there's additional mental stress. Like, I can't believe how many more left I have to do. Or there's three more squats. And that's why I don't think ahead. It's almost like, here, this is one chapter. This is one rep. Make it perfect. Visualize, focus. What's your form going to be? And then that's done. Throw it out. Move on to the next one. Mm-hmm. And it's just, I mean, years and years of mental training. And that comes from gymnastics. And it really comes from, if you mess something up, you need to put it behind you. So, I mean, you look at figure skaters, gymnasts, if you're in a routine and you screw up, how often if somebody falls down, do they fall down again? The first time they screw up, you're more likely to screw up again. And doing that one thing and put it away for me really came back to being a gymnast. You know, you screw up in your floor routine, screw up on the beam, and then that's in your head. I needed to be able to put that out of my head immediately, like it didn't happen, and move on. And I think that's where kind of the beginning of it started.
Is that where the one more rep, I mean, do you remember the first time that you were telling the story when we interviewed you in the last bit, when you're doing these incredible feats of especially muscular endurance, where you've got to do hundreds, if not thousands of reps. You never think about that number. You just think for each one, you think, one more rep. Can I just do one more rep? Just focus on one more rep. And you never even think about the next rep.
It's
this one right now.
And that, again, comes back to people setting limits. Like, well, this is a lot. 50 is a lot, or 100 is a lot. Like, who says?
Right.
And I say to myself, and it's funny, I'm like, if my life depended on it, can I do just one? Like, how hard is a single push-up for me? What amount of my strength or something am I using? It's very psychological. Like, people will say, like, but physiologically, what's different about you? Like, let's study your muscle. Let's pull a muscle biopsy. How is it possible that, like, you know, that you're capable of doing that? You know, is my muscle, is there something any different? You know, am I different at buffering lactic, whatever, in terms of the chemistry of the muscle? I don't believe that I am. I can't absolutely say. And if I am different in some way, it's not, I don't believe anything genetically inherited. I think it just comes from years and years of doing that kind of training.
Yeah. Yeah. So do you remember the first time as a kid that you had to do this repetitive thing that you were like, just one more rep, just one more thing?
Yes. And the first, the first time.
Poor Brad.
Was actually with Brad.
Of course it was.
So we'll pull it all back to me eating the M&Ms. But the first time that I remember not counting and saying I could just do one more.
Just one more M&M.
On the auditorium stage that day doing the push-ups.
Okay. Yeah.
That would be the moment.
And then do you remember thinking about later or even during, like, wait, that worked? Just thinking about, I mean, do you remember actually kind of analyzing that afterwards or even during that that's what you were doing? And
I do remember analyzing that after it, because I remember thinking that when I think towards the end of something, again, you know, still with gymnastics, I'll screw, if I'm so worried about something that's going to happen later, I'm not in the present.
Right.
So this really all comes down to, in any of these things, being in the present. So for an example of that is, people ask me, like, do you ever take off from training? When I if I'm physically don't feel well, I'll take off. But if I'm psychologically incapable of being in the present that day, if there's something on my mind where, you know, I could go in and tinker around and, you know, do some accessory work. But if I'm doing serious training and I'm incapable of being in the present in that moment right there, then training's not right for me that day.
Yeah. Yeah. That's good.
There may or may not be any.
I'm rambling,
genetic.
Aren't I?
No, you're not.
No.
There may or may not be any genetic differences. But your idea about one more rep,
yep.
just this one, you know, the most important rep is that last one, right?
Sure.
So that makes your last one much deeper down the hole than anybody else's. And, you know, genetic difference, whatever, doesn't matter if you didn't have that philosophy,
yep.
and that approach to the training. No genetics would matter anyway. So I think, you know, if we can all learn anything from Gillian today,
sure,
might be to eat your M&Ms and just deal with that next rep.
You think CrossFit has changed that a lot for training in general? It seems like the things that a lot of the CrossFit athletes, especially the games level athletes, there seem to be a fair amount of games athletes that have been able to do or replicate a similar sort of mindset that you have, right? Like the Rich Froning is the kind right. of guy that's just like, he just, same sort of thing. He never really seemed to get jacked up. He never really seemed to get anxious. He never fired. And when an event would start, he would never come out in the lead first. He would just pace the next rep. And he seemed to be able to go into a deeper hole than anybody else would of just.
Matt Frazier's the same way. Yeah. He's so boring to
yeah.
watch
yeah,
because
right.
he's just like breaking rocks.
Well, I absolutely. And we talk about boring to watch. And even as a gymnast, you were not allowed to make facial expressions. Like, that's not just what you did. You don't wince. I mean, you'll get deductions for like the simplest of things. Those things all cost energy. So when I'm thinking, when I go into something, I don't want to do anything else that costs any energy. And I think when you say boring to watch,
yeah.
you know, do we see, you know, laying down on the floor or flailing around? Is this stuff a show? These are all things, you know, that people do,
sure.
whatever, that cost energy. Even running around, getting amped up before. I'm not being critical of the people that do it.
True.
But for me, all energy, everything just goes into that one place.
Yeah. Really good.
The squat, which I'm terrible at. And we do it over and over and over again. It's the same damn thing. You just do a low bar mm-hmm. squat 3 times a week, 2 times a week for decades. And you talk about this sort of meditative approach.
Mm-hmm.
For me, the squat is like a Japanese tea service. Like, I just have to do it over and over, and it's never going to be right. Right. You're just chasing this perfection that sure. you can't have.
Yep.
And I like that about it.
And I agree. It's all ritual.
Yep.
And it's something, training for me is the ritual that guides everything else in my life. Truth is, our lives get crazy and they spin out of control. And what's so special, I said, there's 2 hours out of the day that I am in control.
Yep.
This is the selfish time. This is the me time. And people are like, dude, why would you train? Go do something nice for yourself. Go get your nails done or go do this. I said, somebody else is in control.
That's right.
I get this time where nobody else gets to interfere with. And it's very ritualistic.
Like, yeah.
I've even noted, you know, just open, like, you know, I put my shoes on the same way. I sit in the same spot. Every single thing. And sometimes you don't even realize that you do it, but they're very, very important rituals.
Of course. Yeah. It brings order to the chaos.
Yeah.
That's the thing, right?
Let me tell you about Charity's Saturday morning training ritual.
So she just rolled her eyes.
She just rolled her eyes. So we get started at about 8:30 and
she's
super bad. There's a lot of stuff that has to be done. Let me just say that. There's a lot of stuff that has to be done before she does her first squat set with the bar.
Man, that look is intense. You don't want us to go there?
A lot of stuff has to be done. And if it's not done,
I'm confused. Is it like warm-ups, or you mean like, do you have like a Saturday morning poop or like a Saturday morning delight session with your man before you have to train, or like, what is it?
All those things would make sense,
but
it's none of those.
None of those things.
It just takes a while. Got some stuff to do.
All right. She does not want to be on.
So it kicks off about 8:30 and about 7 minutes after 11.
Oh yeah.
She's ready to put slide plates on the bar.
I know. I remember I've gone over there before. We go over there and have a training day and we all train together. Charity doesn't train at all. When everybody's done training, we're like, let's eat barbecue and swim in the pool. She's like, I got to train now.
She's like, have I got one shoe on?
We've been doing a training session for the last 4 hours. Hey, that's fair. You do that. She's shaking her head no. So
I have something to say about that.
Yeah, let's hear it.
With training, I've learned that I think about how important it is to me. And what I've learned to do is respect everyone else's ritual because they're all individual and unique.
You hear that, Amber?
So,
Listen, we have no choice but to respect it.
But the reason, like, I'll see, you know, somebody, I'll be like, when are they? It takes them 6 minutes to put on their belt. And I'll start getting upset about that. And I said, no. I said, the only thing I said, I need to give them the same respect and let them do whatever it is. This is their time. So even if it drives me crazy, even if they hold on to the bar for 45 seconds, you know, talking to it before they get underneath it, you know, what would I want somebody to do for me? So as crazy and as annoying as any of those things are, that I never, ever interfere with anybody else's training ritual.
Because nobody's interfering with you talking to the Elvis and your mitochondria.
Nope.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
I really do.
Tell us more about that. I think that's significant, and I think it's important. Like, you say the Elvis thing, and it's...
Well, we make it a joke, but it's not... You're serious. I mean, it's not Elvis.
Am I serious that it's Elvis?
No, I know it's not Elvis, or you're serious it's Elvis, but you're really talking to
like
the cells.
Like nutritional partitioning and shuttling into where I want it to go.
You can at least... You believe
Tell us about it.
Yeah.
I do. I think we underestimate and don't do enough with... I think there are people that study the mind and all kinds of stuff, and I think there are people that study the body. But the connection between how powerful. So I don't know that I told you this story, but I wanted to get hypnotized. Read these books on self-hypnosis because I still never pulled a 500-pound deadlift. It just hasn't happened for me. And several years ago, I was like, do I pay a hypnotist? And I did all this reading on kind of self-hypnosis. So I was like, I've done everything I can physically. Everything, all of the training, and you can only do so much. More is not always better. But have I done everything I can in my mind? You know, if I put everything I can into that. So when it comes to eating, and this is not an excuse, my diet is poor. That's probably a whole other subject. I believe that there's some amount of control over that.
And always have?
Yeah. I mean, people will say to me that
when I was in the fifth grade,
so food is absolutely fuel. And I kind of take it a little far and make a joke that yes, would I do better with good nutrition? Absolutely. But I think there's some amount of control.
If it's not too private.
Yep.
Could you
date what I eat?
Some of that, that inner dialogue about what you're telling your inner Elvis.
Like when I tell it for like red dye number 4 to go to my quads. So it'll be a little talk. So at night, I eat most of my calories late at night. I eat fairly clean during the day. And then I eat 3,000 to 4,000 calories of sugar and fat, some wine, ice cream, cookies, candy, donuts between like 9 and 11 p.m. and go to sleep with like chocolate on my mouth, get it on the pillow, like breathing like Darth Vader, probably run a temperature of 103 through the night.
So that's eating right there.
So maybe to make myself feel better about it, but like as I'm eating it, I'm thinking, this is what I'm going to do tomorrow. And I was like, okay, you know, that there was just 200 grams of fat. I'm going to utilize this tomorrow. This is where I need it.
But then you visualize your squat. You said that you think about your muscles and what they needed to do. So
yes.
So what is that like when you're thinking about that?
Or do you ever call out to the ice cream under the squat bar that you had last night and say, hey,
Klondike bar,
I need you right now.
So once it's done, I don't. But I visualize less so the movement for the next day. Like I'll do that as I'm going to sleep if it's an important movement, but I'll visualize like the digestive process and how I want to utilize it and all of the little things that are going on inside in like glycogen and other stuff. And they're like little cartoons in my mind while this is happening.
That's what I mean.
Like, I'm like, I can store more glycogen than anybody. I'll say to myself, I'm like, I'm going to store more glycogen than somebody else can. But I'm like, again, who's to say? I feel like we're so limited by what people call the norms. It's like, well, this is what the research says, or this is what normal is. But I don't believe I have a normal.
Well, it appears that you have, there's something ingrained in your psyche that has made you not accept normal, not just in the physical realm, but also even just in the sort of social and cultural realm, because we were talking about that you have been wired to, like, you would go, okay, so then I got to high school and there wasn't a physical fitness team. And so I just started a physical fitness team at one of the largest high schools in the country. And then, you know, it's kind of always been this thing like, okay, you're not just going to try to beat the push-up record for
there's a place that comes from.
Where does that come from?
So my father's mom, so my grandmother, she passed away in 93, but she really taught me that don't let anybody set limits on you. You could do anything you want to do. There's, if it's a man's role, woman's role, there is none of that. But, you know, you be your best self and don't let anybody tell you no or you can't. And that was ingrained in me from a very, very early age. You know, I really looked up to her, spent a lot of time with her. She was a physical role model. Like, she had an exceptional physique. You know, she did hard work. And I would watch her in the garden, and I'd watch like the sinew and muscles in her legs and other stuff. And she would garden in like little hot pants and, you know, and this tight blouse and these platform shoes. And I'm like, she's wearing heels in the garden. That's pretty cool. And I remember wearing this obnoxious t-shirt when I was five. Like, anything boys can do, girls can do better. And I was a little bit of an arrogant little kid, but I was not going to let anybody tell me that I couldn't do something.
Sure. So can I push on this a little bit and even
sure.
make it a little bit awkward?
Okay.
It is also clear that you were destined for greatness in a lot of these realms. But the world is also full of people who have been told that they can do anything that they put their mind to. And then they go on American Idol and they sing on that first week that you watch American Idol, and they're horrible. They're horrible. They have no pitch. They're tone deaf. Their voice is not pleasing, but they're doing the thing that someone said, you can do anything you put your mind to. What do we do with those people who can never be, they're never going to be Pavarotti. It's not going to happen. That mindset works for somebody who's destined for greatness, but there are a lot of people who aren't.
But honesty is helpful. I mean, I remember getting to a point in gymnastics where I wasn't going to go to the Olympics, and I don't want somebody telling me I'm great or to tell somebody they're great. If somebody isn't good at it or doesn't have what it takes, or, I mean, I guess they could, I'll tell people. So I do prep for bodybuilders or people that want, and some people just don't have the genetic shape. And I will be very honest with the client
right.
and say, you can be your best. You can go to the next level. You could set your own goals. You can be better than you are now. You will never be this. You will never meet what the current standard is for that.
Sure.
And I'll wrap it up in a nice package. People were honest with me. There were things that I was not very good at.
Sure. That makes sense. So there's a part of that that's sort of dream crushing in its presentation.
But sometimes it opens up another dream.
Right. And right. Okay.
So you said, you know, don't let anybody tell you no, blah, 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 blah. But then sometimes you have to tell people, it's not no, but you give them some guidance.
Like steer them in a different direction sometimes, or...
So there are certain maybe... trusted people that can tell us no, maybe. But, and you can be that trusted person for some people.
I
and
think
you had
so.
A gymnastics coach, I guess. I'm guessing that took you aside and was like, you're scared of the balance beam, it's over.
I think so. I think there's quite a bit of being self-aware that comes with all of this. I think throughout time was pretty self-aware of, I mean, myself, like the things that... So I ended... There were other things that I would... I have other things that I'm passionate about, or that I would have rather have done.
What?
There's, I mean, I've never done it. This is going to shock people if I said it, but if someone's like, if you could wake up tomorrow and be anything, and the funny thing is, like, I'm the worst singer on the planet or whatever, but like, I would be an opera singer. Like, that would be something that...
It's the costumes again.
No, it is. I would be something in a costume, or I would be a pop star or something. Like, that's not something that I'm good at. I've always loved the physical, but sometimes I've banged on one door and I'm like, well, I'm not so good at that and stuff. Like even gymnastics, for me, I was excellent and stuff, but I was never going to be an Olympian.
Yep.
And so I ended up doing something else, but people are like, you only do the things that you're good at. And it's a little bit of a true statement. I sure. start a lot of things. And I'm going to be honest, I gravitate towards sticking to things that I'm pretty good at.
Well, and when you do that, then it's a lot harder for, you know, then you don't have to accept the letting people tell you no, right? If somebody says, like when you're 14 years old and you're a freshman in high school and they say, you can't break the records on the record board. And you go, well, hold on. I know I'm really good at it already. I can do this. But if you're like, hey, what I really want to do is I want to be a professional opera singer, but you're not a good professional opera singer. So then... You know, does that make sense? Then the no is different.
But I have, I guess, a point with striving for greatness in anything. It's that it's never for me about comparison. I will see what other people are doing, but I don't compare because I'm like, why compare to somebody else? Because there's something even beyond that. Sure. So like for powerlifting meets, or like people are like, do you go on Instagram and, you know, look at what other people are doing? I said, I don't care what other people are doing, because that's another limit. Like, I don't even want to think about that. Like, what is possible? Forget what somebody else is doing. And it's irrelevant. And I don't want that coming in and affecting me. So when I'm striving, and people are like, well, you're a rival, or if you're a champion, it's like, well, you have to beat whatever that person is. And I think it goes so far beyond that. So I don't ever look. The only time I've ever looked at what somebody else is doing is if it's something where they're directly interacting with me, like a fight. Like if you're going to, you know,
like a fight.
Right. If you have an opponent that you're physically interacting, sure, you need to be well aware. But if I'm going to a powerlifting meet, how much the girl next to me could squat is irrelevant to
me. Right.
So I think, well, I'll ask you this. Do you think then that maybe your greatest advantage is the self-awareness that you have?
I think two things. My self-awareness.
And your inner Elvis.
And a sense, honestly, a sense of humor about it all. Yeah. I don't take it too seriously. I see this as a journey. It's going to take me in. Wolf was teasing me about my old training log last night that it was called Jillian's Journey. And I do it all.
That.
Yep. I just kind of do it all for the experience and for the love of it. And this, if something is not bringing me joy, even if it's bringing me success, I'll walk away.
It's good. Things that bring her value.
So I think we're done with this one.
It's really good.
Go follow.
By the way, we didn't even mention last time. You went and competed at the, what was the thing the last couple of years? The big super athlete thing?
The Super League.
The Super League.
Yeah.
How did you do at that?
No, it's a world champion.
Didn't even mention it. It's part of your story. So, of all the superhumans on Earth.
The Super League. Yeah, go look that up. It's crazy.
It's crazy. So
it's like some Vince McMahon XFL meets CrossFit meets bodybuilding.
Yeah.
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
So follow Gillian on Instagram. She's at Gillian Ward Athlete, right?
Yep.
And go to what, CrystalCoastStrength.com. Strength with a G.
Strength.
There you go. Yeah, that's it.
All right. Welcome to Texas. And you can follow us at Barbell Logic. You can go to our website, barbell-logic.com, and sign up for the newsletter.
We'd love for you to come get coaching.
We will make you stronger. And go to iTunes, give us 5 stars, and follow us on YouTube. So we'll be posting videos in addition to these long-form podcasts. And so that's our show. Thanks for listening.
Thank you for having me.